started. I can promise to you that this is the last one with so many speakers. We will not have another one like that. It explains itself by what you say. It's a powerful topic and also powerful audience that we have, and also great participation from the side of the speakers. My name is Jean-Paul Brice Affana. I will have to hold my name plate like that all the time. Margaux will help me. I'm from Cameroon and I work with the International Association for the Advancement of Innovative Approaches to Global Challenges. It's been very long, we have to take a break and continue. And also with the Commonwealth Climate Change Network and AED, Action Vital pour le Développement Durable. And I am with Margaux Jobin.
Hi everyone, I'm with the international network called Climate, so you can see in the top left-hand corner. Today we're going to try to speak a little bit on how we can involve youth and make them, like, bring them to action. We have a lot of people around the table, and the good thing is that we don't have only young people, so that means that maybe we have ideas coming from less young generations, and that's a really good sign. If we have to talk about young people involved in the UNFCCC, we have to talk about YOUNGO, the young constituency to the UNFCCC, and for that we have Timothy Damon, that's the North focal point for YOUNGO this year, and I'll leave him to say, tell us a bit more about what YOUNGO is and how it can help in youth involvement.
Okay, and before giving the floor to Tim, sorry for taking it back, I would like to give a bit of introduction about this event and the topic that we would like to go through. You have seen it on the screen on the UNFCCC SP44 agenda, but it's also important that we go through it just for 1 minute. Communicating climate change and empowering action, youth, social media, music and resource mobilization. Why is this topic so touching for the speakers? Why is it so touching for you as participants in this room and us as moderators? It's because there have been so many good actions coming from young people and their organizations across the world involved in the UNFCCC process or other environmental processes. And most of the time they use very innovative, creative and attractive ways of engaging each other, engaging their peers, engaging other people, intergenerational equity and cooperation, and also to inspire new people to take action on the topic. And to be able to have this work, this role they play, being powerful, we need to find ways to engage them in a very more dynamic way and also to allocate the resources that they need to be more impactful on the ground. And in February, during the ECOSOC forum, a wonderful workshop took place in New York, and Timothy was there, for example, and a few of you were there as well, and I have no doubt. And they went through this topic again, how young people are making a change, are making impact, and how can we support them better. And very good ideas came through, and some of them were really related to what YOUNGO does, and also to what each of our organization is doing already on the ground, and also how does this need more support. So the item is to reflect the outcome of this workshop, but also to bring in new blood, new perspective from different organizations, and especially youth-led initiatives from across the world. And as Margaux said, Timothy Damon will be the first discussion on this topic, and we have two respondents, Miroslav Polzer and Joseph Robertson will be responding to what the youth will say, and we will start exactly with Timothy, and thanks again for...
Well, thank you very much. As said, I am focal point from the Global North. We also have a Global South focal point for YOUNGO. And in that context, I will be talking about youth engagement and empowerment within the UNFCCC space. Obviously, it's also important to do it at all levels, national, local. But YOUNGO is a network of NGOs that are coming to engage with this process, although many of them do that work domestically at home as well. So we have in YOUNGO three main proposals that we're working on for this topic. The first of these is to enhance the visibility of youth in this process by having a youth pavilion at the annual Conference of Parties. You know, we figure countries have their pavilions, why shouldn't the global youth have a pavilion as well? because even though there are many young people in attendance, they aren't necessarily visible. You don't know where to go to find them. And it makes it much more difficult for them to showcase their work, to engage with other parties and stakeholders. So it's a very simple remedy to have a dedicated space within the conference venue that would host myriad youth events instead of having them scattered around in side event venues through the normal process. And it would also really help YOUNGO to work better itself, because consistent meeting space, more flexibility in what we're going to do. So it would really make a big difference. But just having a youth pavilion is not enough, because we struggle to have young people able to come and engage in the process in the first place. And this is particularly the case for youth coming from the Global South. And we need, therefore, as part of this resource mobilization, which is a broad theme for today, to have resources explicitly to help them. And we were fortunate through the French government to have a grant which brought some Global South young people to Paris. Other governments have supported us sporadically in the past, but it hasn't been done in a consistent, reliable manner. So we'd like to build on these prior best practices, experiences we've had, to ensure that for Morocco, we will have a much even stronger Global South presence. And that needs to take the form not only of financial support through scholarships, but also through accreditation, because there are many fewer organizations from the Global South which are even accredited to the process to have access to badges for participants, and also access to the country, so visa and travels. And it was actually very reassuring to hear earlier from the Moroccan presidency that they're going to take steps to facilitate the visa acquisition process, because there have been many young people at prior COPs who have been unable to attend because of those visa issues. So that would be very helpful to us as well. And then our third topic is on official youth delegates being included on all parties. And currently there are a few countries such as the Netherlands, Finland, Belgium that have these youth delegates, but there's, again, not a consistency in what those programs look like, and that's a very small number of parties. And young people as observers, we don't have access to most of the real negotiations which are happening. And the successes that we've had getting Article 12 on education into the convention, my own work with getting intergenerational equity into the preamble, all of that was very hard fought, and more hard fought than it needed to be, because we didn't have access to the actual text in the negotiations except through these very limited number of youth delegates with party badges and relying on countries to be our champion in the process. And if we really are talking about empowering and including young people, you know, so many of us are coming here, we need to be able to translate that input into the process. And youth delegates are the best way to do that. But it also is a two-way street in that you can then engage the young people back home in those countries much more effectively if you have a well-informed young person in this process who can go back and explain it to them and break it down in a way that is also a theme of this event, more understandable to them and more relatable. And just having it delivered by another young person makes a world of difference in that. And would it be much more inspirational, oh, well, if this young person can be involved at that level and do all of these amazing things and understand what's going on, then yeah, I feel more empowered to be able to contribute as well. So we'll be inviting parties to sign a declaration on the youth delegate area. We're already initiating discussions with the Moroccan presidency and other parties about youth pavilions, and we'll be looking for resource mobilization to support Global South attendance as well. And with that, I'm at my 5 minutes and I'll hand things off, but YOUNGO is very pleased to invite your collaboration.
Thank you so much. And exactly, YOUNGO is the overall umbrella network engaging many organizations from all around the world. And we now move to a more regional focused organization, which engage four regions, Pacific, Caribbean, Asia, and Africa and Europe. And Renice Annalie Bostic is from the Commonwealth Youth Climate Change Network. She works as an advocate for climate change and especially the interests of this network. And she also does a lot of blogging. She's a Commonwealth Youth Correspondent on a platform that is called Your Commonwealth. And Anali is going to present us the key activities they have been doing and also which type of impact they have been making on the ground from the grassroots level. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. And as Jean-Paul said, I'm from representing the Commonwealth Youth Climate Change Network. I'm very delighted to be here with you today. Also, as a Commonwealth correspondent and a communication specialist by profession with specific research interests in climate change, I'm especially excited to speak on this topic because it's something that I practice every day, and I think it's a very important aspect to look at when you're addressing climate change, because it's not everyone just can't come and look at a document and understand exactly what's going on in the UNFCCC. So we have to find a way to communicate to our citizens and to active young people as well. As a citizen from Barbados, this also is very important because, as Tim said, the global south, as it's termed, don't always have the access to attend events or to have access to information. So finding ways to engage young people, even ones who are in remote areas, is especially important. For the CYCN, the aim is to mainstream the youth perspective within climate change policy discussion and discourse. And we understand that the world needed an ambitious agreement, but that agreement will not be effective if the youth are not involved, if the youth are not engaged. At the end of the day, we're talking about the future. And if you don't include the voices of that same future, then it's pointless. We must have a say in what that world is going to look like, and we must take decisive action, lead the charge in order to get to that position. In the Commonwealth, the youth are already taking key steps in addressing climate change. Through the CYCN, for example, members participated in COP17, COP20, COP21, Rio Plus 20, the 2014 CIS conference as well, and participated in a way that made a difference. It wasn't just to go and observe, but to actually engage and to actually put forward solutions to problems. And we published reports and recommendations that we thought as young people were needed. With the support of the youth division of the Commonwealth Secretariat, young people are also actively engaged in terms of communicating about climate change. So as Jean-Paul said, we have a blog, Your Commonwealth, and through this blog, that's where young people go and they engage about many different areas of interest, but specifically environment and climate change, as we're speaking about today. We have a lot of young people who have been following the UNFCCC processes and also at the local level and are able to report on what's happening at home in the 53 Commonwealth states and how what's happening in UNFCCC is impacting them and how they propose going forward. For example, the SIDS Youth AIM Hub, which is a CYCN member from Mauritius, they launched a project in 2014 on social media that was called Seeing Blue Project. By using the hashtag Seeing Blue, they were able to disseminate information with the intention of encouraging young Mauritians to know and care about the marine environment. And the project also included an essay competition. We had people who were sending in blogs, sending in videos, which were so dynamic, it was simply overwhelming. And that's the kind of work that the CYCN wants and tries to encourage. It's not just about coming out and engaging at a global level or even a sub-regional level, but it's to have a trickle effect at a local level within the Commonwealth itself. For me, as a Commonwealth correspondent, I honestly believe that it has to start from a very young age. If we can instill behavioral change at a young age, then we have a chance to actually have a lifestyle change. Because as much as you can have a policy and you can have agreements, if people don't take a conscious decision to actually make a change, then nothing is going to change. So we have to start with our very young people and train them to live an environmentally conscious life. But in order to do this, we also need education, we need training, we need capacity building. There also needs to be access to information, and that's not always the case. Access to information means we also have to be able to communicate this information. And therefore, we need to be able to find ways to reach our young people. Sometimes it might be something as simple as terminology. They may not identify with climate change. They may not identify with the term environmental protection. And it's not that you can just say a one-size-fits-all term is going to work. You have to look at the specific country, the specific region, and determine what is the best way to reach those young people. And I also want to say that if we can come together as young people and decide that we are not just going to sit idly by and inherit a planet that is so damaged by climate change that we can't see a viable future for ourselves, then we need to sit down and really think, what are we really doing? What are we really going to school for? What are we really doing all these things for? Because at the end of the day, we need to be able to stand up, take action, and we can't expect people, older generation, to just do it for us. We have to be able to take a stand and just encourage everyone, encourage our peers, encourage people at school, our families, to take decisive action in combating climate change. So the CYCN is trying to do this on the ground by helping and facilitating regional work, helping and facilitating youth coordinators to have an impact in their local communities. And we hope that by working with, partnering with YOUNGO and partnering with other institutions, that we can help the Commonwealth network and also help the region, globally, the youth on the ground to implement positive change. Thank you.
I'm always very moved when I hear that people are acting all around the world, especially when they look younger than I am, and I'm just like, I wasn't doing that earlier in my life. The good thing is, when we want to take action all together, we have sometimes people that are listening to us and are coming to our actions. I'm thinking about Adriana, that came to COY11 last year, and what I think you had a good time when you came to visit us over there, and we had a good time having you over there. You're specialized in education, mainly some other topics, but young people, you deal with us a lot. What would you respond to our call for action?
Hi, good afternoon, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank Miro and also the organizers, YOUNGO, and all the youth organizations that have put together this side event, because I think, as you have highlighted, youth are not the future, youth are the present, and you are agents of change. And just to listen all of you, your ideas, your proposals are fundamental to move this process forward. I would like to share with you some of the actions that we, as the UNFCCC Secretariat, are promoting to enhance the participation of youth people in climate action. First of all, I would like to say that the team that was working together for the COI last year, as well the last COI, have mobilized more than 5,000 young people from different countries around the world, and bring multiple activities, workshop, training sessions, and as well some key recommendations that have already support the process of the Paris Agreement. Then congratulations to all of you. But also, as you are participating at the international level, also you are making a big change at the local and the national level. I would like to mention that every year, your parties have recognized the key role that young people play in climate action. And for that, parties adopted the Doha World Program in 2012 that highlight the importance of empowering the new generations to take action on climate change. It is the Doha World Program on Article 6 of the Convention. And there are six areas that you already have mentioned: education, training, public access to information, public participation, and international cooperation. This year is an opportunity because PACT is undertaking the intermediate review of the Doha World Programme. And these ideas that you are suggesting, you can bring directly to the negotiators because they will have some recommendations how this World Programme will continue from 2016 to 2020. These are some of the proposals that Timo shared was part of the submission of YOUNGO and other youth organizations. And these submissions are available on our website. Regarding the negotiations started yesterday, the informal consultations. Part of it started exchanging good practices, and the negotiations will continue on Saturday. And you are welcome to discuss with your delegations about your ideas and your proposals. And as Timo said, YOUNGO has proposed to have a youth pavilion. I really encourage you to talk to your delegates, to talk to your every country, to bring these proposals because they are the ones that can really support. I think that the long-term transformation, we need to invest in education, we need to invest in youth, as this is the largest generation of young people, and many are from developing countries, and I think that it's fundamental to empower them. I wanted to share with you what we have done together at COP21 and why it is a good practice and how it could help to inspire others. Paris Agreement has one article dedicated to education. It's Article 12 that talks about education, training, and public awareness. And I wanted to highlight that young people work together with different party delegates to make possible that this article is part of the Paris Agreement. Then well done and congratulations. But as well, there are multiple activities that every year take place during the COP and before. For instance, the COY and the Young and Future Generation Day. This video will show you what you have also done in Paris.
This is a childish wake-up call. So we are here to give you the world's simplest lesson in climate change. This is what will happen to a planet with too much CO2.
I am very touched by your decision to choose this message for your t-shirts, because from the point of view, these three are not separate chapters. Because there is a very, very compelling mandate, but there's also an imperative. There's a moral imperative, there's a technical imperative, there's a financial imperative, there is a political imperative, and finally, there is a generational imperative here. And from your point of view, these three are not separate chapters, they do come together, and they come together now. Thank you for this very nice opening of Youth Day. I know we're going to be having many other activities today that I very much look forward to. Okay, your presence at the COP is important to remind us all, but it's also what you're doing at home, because that is where the rubber hits the ground. That is where you can really make a true difference. So thank you for both.
Children are the future, and it's for them and for their children that we are here and that we work 24 hours a day to try and secure an ambitious climate agreement here in Paris. And we are writing history.
So many communities are suffering. So many people are suffering. There are so many climate refugees around the planet that are seeing the worst of the effects, and it's only going to continue from there unless action is taken today. And now more than ever, we have the opportunity to take action. Because now is the time that our generation stands up to be leaders today. Let's create the right partnership. Let's build the correct future that we want to pass on to, that we're proud of passing on to future generations. Thank you.
This is not just a COP. This is the COP of your generation.
Just a few words to say how much France is proud to receive COP21. And to salute Christina Figueres, who is making a fantastic work, a huge work, to make from this COP21 a real success.
right now. Was that dead? Yeah.
Keywords. You have seen what you have done. The slogan of our t-shirt in Paris was, we can, we must, we'll do, and also we can feel satisfied that we have done. But now the big challenge is the implementation at local and national level. And you, as the agents of change, play a fundamental role, and you really can empower others. You can connect with others, for that YOUNGO and this network are fundamental. You can inspire by action, as Gandhi said, every person must be the change that wants to see in the world. And the most important is mobilizing action. Why? Because there is an urgency. There is not a second planning, and it is the opportunity of this generation to make this transformation. The congratulations and your voices. So all of these are fundamental. Bring your ideas to the negotiation, but talk to your delegates, but also go home and implement this climate action. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Adriana. Go home and implement this concrete action. That's the commitment we have to do here. And I think one simple question I have for the audience, I think everyone has an answer. When you take 6 plus 6, what do you get? 6 plus 6. What do you get?
12.
So we move from Article 6 to Article 12, and I think the Secretariat and the parts are so wonderfully connected to the reality. When you do 6 action, and you do other 6 actions, then you have 12 actions, and it's more powerful. So we are happy that we move from Article 6 to Article 12 to focus on education and public awareness, and this shows that we have the possibility to increase the commitment that we do, and the sectarian work is really fantastic on all of that, and thank you also for YOUNGOs for supporting this action since many years from now. Many of you have heard about COP in my city, I'm sure about that. But do you know the organization behind? I'm sure you know the organization behind this project, COP in my city. You know the name? Anyone has the answer? COP in my city? One picture with Adriana for the winner, COP in my city. She's a high-level person. We have to get the opportunity, COP in my city. Climate, yeah, we got the answer. So Climate is a powerful student think tank and do. Yes, I got it. I always say think tank only, but they say yes, we must add do because we have to do action. And what they have been doing since 2, 3, 4 years from now is just powerful. 5 years, I remove one, sorry for that. So since 5 years, Climate is engaging students, young people around the world, and they make change. And Margaux was telling to us that they are thinking about moving from engagement for global advocacy to concrete action at national level. And Climate will be happy to show you some powerful social media communication ways they have been developing to engage young people in COP21 advocacy, and also how they were so connected to the reality of everything we do in our daily life. And when you see the messages they were sharing, you were connecting it to what you do and you were understanding the message behind. I was really impressed by this when I saw it, and many of us probably didn't have that opportunity. So I will invite Yann, Lesestre, and Margaux, Jobin, to present this powerful project from Climate and how they were able to use social media and communication to reach out to people, especially young people, in terms of climate change. And thank you for taking the floor.
Thank you for setting the audience expectations so high. So Climate is an international think and tank with members in more than 30 countries, mostly developing countries, or non-annex one countries, as we can say here. At the very beginning, our members know that climate change is a global issue, that this issue will affect them personally and their generation as a whole, and they want to do something against climate change. But they may not know how to start, and this is our job. Climate's mission is to provide youth the tools they need to become a change maker on climate change. We invite our members to join with one of our research projects on key climate change issues, such as communicating with an innovative manner on climate change, but also we have also projects about climate finance, about climate migration. But this is only one of our of the aspects of climate. We are also a do-tank, which means we use the result of our research project to implement concrete action project. I would like to highlight two of our projects, CompuMerCity and InnovCity. CompuMerCity is a serious game organized to raise awareness about UNFCCC talk. Basically, we propose during a few hours 20 to 30 participants to become a party. They can play, I don't know, China, India, the US, or Italia, actual parties of the UNFCCC, and during the 2 or 3 hours, they must respect the real party guidelines. And all the participants must find an agreement to limit the global warming to 2 degrees Celsius. Each party will propose features to reduce their greenhouse gas emission, develop countries will pledge for financement, and developing countries can ask finance to implement action. And at the end, participants can understand what are the main political issues about UNFCCC. They understand what are the main barriers, why can be difficult to reach an agreement. But the most important part of this project is not really the simulation in itself. The simulation is just about 20 youth and raising awareness. What is interesting is that during 2 hours or 3, participants will meet other youth, and those youth share the same idea that climate change is an important issue and they have to do something about it. And then comes the second step of the CompuMerCity project, implement concrete actions. Last year, more than 100 CompuMerCity were organized in 25 countries, and we estimate that we reach between 8,000 and 10,000 youth. One of our other projects is InnovCity. An InnovCity is a conference organized to showcase local initiatives to tackle climate change. We invite youth entrepreneurs from startups or from companies, public authority and also NGO members to talk about their project in a specific city. And at the end, the audience can realize that that solutions do exist in their city, that they can do something against climate change. And the best part is when the participants think, well, I realize that so many initiatives exist, that they work, and I want to launch my own project to be part of this global fight against climate change.
I'm going to speak a little bit more about what we do on a more local level. What we saw during the COP22 presentation is that getting the global issue is important. Then we want to take action on a local level because it's easier to reach out to people around you than to people that are far, far away. But in climates, we're trying to reach out to people who are really far away. And a good point is that we have developed communication projects, not just research projects on climate change, but we're trying to see how we could reach out to those people that are very far away, either because they're on the other end of the globe or just because they don't really know about climate change. So last year during an intersession in Bonn, actually, we launched the Climate Nerd Chronicle that you can see on the left of the screen. Well, the idea is to use any geeky references you can have about Star Wars, Alice in Wonderland, or even just Batman or Superman to try to explain and reach out to young people on what does it mean to work on climate change and on climate talks. This was met with a lot of great responses, and we tried to develop it a bit more. We're trying to see who is using those geeky references today, and also how we could impersonate the climate change as a super villain that we saw a little bit earlier. And the idea is you're gonna think of what a bad climate change effect and make a super villain out of it, and how you can destroy it and be your own climate superhero. And that works pretty well, but we're not showing you supervillains today because they're going to be unveiled in a month for Climate Nerd Anniversary. So if you want to stay tuned, you should go to our website. As well, when we wanted to reach out, Adriana mentioned it a little bit earlier, we co-organized the COY last year, COY 11 in Paris. The idea was not just to reach out to people who knew about climate change, but people who wanted to talk about climate and energy, food, agriculture, education, economy, everything was involved in there, because we wanted to show that climate change is not just a climate change issue, it touches every part of society. So we wanted to gather more than 5,000 young people in Paris and also all over the world with the local COYs. We had 8 local COYs outside of Paris, which helped us mobilize around 8,500 young people all over the world for 3 days. Which is a big number when you know that during the previous COY, only 1,000 young people were able to make it to Lima. So we just wanted to not just reach out through internet, but also mobilize them on a local level. And that inspired Climates to have also local branches in order to just reach out to local communities and say, you can fight climate change in your own way, you can mobilize people in your own way, and it's just up to you to get together and think about what you can do. So we have a local branch in Mali, stop me if I'm saying anything stupid. And we're thinking of having a second one in Nepal, where there's a lot of very motivated young people from Climates. But to get to those people, we also need to help out the COY organizers from this year, which are the COY12 organizers. And I know that Yann gathered a lot of intel from last year and can tell you a bit more about what we would recommend from COY11 to COY12.
Yeah, just a few words on COY 12. COY 12 will organize the week before COP 22 in Marrakech, from Thursday, November 3rd to from Thursday, November 3rd to Saturday, November 5th. They expect several thousand youth to attend COY 12, like COY 11 last year. And there will be also a local COY in various countries, but I don't know exactly which one. This year, COY 12 will be organized by 6 Moroccan-based organizations, and Climates is just here to share our experience from last year, but we are not part of the organizing committee. That's why I was asked to give an advice to COY 12 organizers during this conference. My advice will be the following. They will realize that organizing a COY is an exciting work, but also a very, very tiring task. They will have a lot of emails, a lot of short nights, and sometimes they can feel like it doesn't work because it's so much work. But I think they have realized that their future audience expectation is very high, and they can achieve something really, really big. COY 12 can be an opportunity to organize a youth mobilization right before COP22, and to gather youth from all over the world and to use their energy to create something big. To empower youth, to train them, and to give them the tool to realize their own obligation when they will be back to their native country. And what I would suggest to COY12 organizers is to always keep in mind why they are doing this. And I think they know that all their work will be worth it when they will see the result in November.
I agree, short nights, but it's worth it. Thank you. Speaking of international youth, I think we have Michael coming all the way from China to tell us a bit more about what he does with the Youth Think Center, if that's correct. Can you tell us a bit more?
Okay, thank you, the moderator, and thank you, the organizer, to invite me here. My name is Michael Xu, and I come from China. Now I live in Paris, but before we worked for 4 years to engage Chinese youth into climate action. And I will give just two cases about like how Chinese youth engage in this kind of climate action and public affair. One is our first program held in 2012. And another one is the recent case in 2015 in Paris. So, and I will also give some reflection on our experience to compare with the different ages cases. And the first one program we did is our firstly participate in the global music context, which is initiated by IAAI, and it's to celebrate for the Rio Plus 20 in 2012. And we need to use Chinese social media to engage Chinese youth into this campaign. And we use a tool called Chinese Twitter, which is called Weibo. And so that young people can directly upload the video, their music work to on the social media, and invite their friends to transfer and share this kind of the great work. And this kind of the mechanism is very innovative at that time, and also it's attracted a lot of the key opinion leaders in China, so that they also help to promote this campaign. And also we cooperate with the a museum called Ukraine Congress of Committee of America, UCCA, to hold the final music context, and also invite some UN officers to give honor this finalist. So this is the program in 2012, and in 2015, we cooperate with the United Nations Millennium Campaign to make promote the My World program, My World campaign in China, which is to let young people choose which kind of the options like climate change, poverty, security, peace, this kind of issue, which one is their most top preference among these 17 social sustainable development goals. And this is also for Chinese youth, first time to they can choose directly what they really pay attention among the sustainable development issues. And we finally get over 200,000 participations, which is also the top 10 largest participation in the world. And how did we achieve this? We use a new technology which is called WeChat, and we cooperate with the media called NetEase in China, and we invite the two famous actors to put their image and their encouragement words into HTML5 pages, so that young people can scan and watch it on their mobile phone, and they also can invite and share these HTML5 pages to their friends. And besides that, we design a mechanism of competition, so that basically this HTML5 is to invite people to vote, which kind of the options you prefer. So we will select the five winners who attend the largest votes, the most votes, so that we will sponsor them to fly to Paris to attend the COP21. And when they came to Paris, they will also use some typical board to collect all these signature and words from like the politicians, celebrities, and we take photos and upload it on the social media. So people who maybe not have chance to go to Paris, they will also see like these encouraging words from these famous people, figures. And at last, we hold a side event, offline event called World Youth Forum.
Why did we say, okay, I come from China?
Yeah, so it's our, my colleague in COP21. So we also hold the conference in Paris, which is called World Youth Forum. And we invite some talent, young people, to give the TED style talk. For example, one girl, she do the online crowdfunding for a $10,000 to sponsor her to go to architect to do the scientific research. So this story is very inspiring, and we invite them to come to give the speech. So that's the launch of our campaign in 2015. So it's the first step on do the online campaign and then do the offline campaign and then hold the conference to celebrate, to conclude all these achievements. And compare with these two cases, two programs we did in 2012 and 2015, I give some my conclusion of how can we improve the youth campaign, youth mobilization on climate action. So first thing is to use the new latest technology to help us to promote better these campaigns, like the HTML5, like the virtual reality. This new technology is very easily approached to young people. So it's better to attract, to be eye-catching. The second thing is to, if we want to raise the public awareness, we try to mobilize the results of the key opinion leaders, especially in China. There's a lot of the key opinion leaders who have like over millions or thousand millions fans in their social media, and they are very, very willing to help young people to promote or share their programs. And the third thing is empowerment, because in 2012, we always like design these programs for young people and tell them like what shall you do, and you just follow the schedule and the timetable. But in 2015, we found